The Philippines' defense chief accuses China of deflecting attention from its illegal activities in the West Philippine Sea.
More schools and local government units across the Philippines suspend in-person classes due to extreme heat.
Cebu City declares a state of water crisis. We'll talk to the local government about the current situation there.
And the international community demands accountability after an Israeli airstrike killed 7 aid workers in Gaza.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crow.
And I'm Denise Inside.
You're watching Top Story. We begin with the Philippine Defense Chief doubling down on his criticism of Chinese activities in the West Philippine Sea. Secretary Gilberto Teodoro Jr. on Tuesday said Beijing is bringing up a supposed status quo deal with Manila to deflect public attention from its illegal maritime activities. He was referring to a so-called gentleman's agreement allegedly made by the Duterte administration with China that prevented it from fortifying the dilapidated Navy outpost in Ayungin Shoal. Teodoro says while someone must be held responsible for that deal, Filipinos should not lose sight of China's illegal activities in Philippine waters. Former President Rodrigo Duterte has denied through his former spokesperson that he made such a deal. Attorney Salvador Panelo accused a person who made the claim as someone who wants publicity. The deal was bared by another of Duterte's former spokespersons, Harry Roque.
Meanwhile, attorney Harry Roque believes the Philippines would lose Ayungin Shoal if it keeps a hardline stance against China. He claims the Marcos administration's policy on China is leading nowhere given Beijing's continuing aggression. For Roque, the Duterte administration had the better foreign policy, claiming it was able to maintain BRP Sierra Madre without attracting China's attention.
We now find a situation where we have clearly treated China not even as a friend, but perhaps as an enemy, which to me will not bode well for the country. The better option is the option opted by President Duterte. Let's proceed with matters that we could proceed on, matters like trade and investments, and set aside these disputes for the time being. If we persist in what we're doing, China will just bar us from Ayungin altogether. And, you know, mark my word, I said it in your program. If we continue with this course of action, we will be forced to retrieve our soldiers because they will starve to death.
Roque now says the Philippine government could decommission the BRP Sierra Madre, the country's lone Navy outpost in the West Philippine Sea, to ease tensions.
Make it into a Coast Guard vessel so that it will not be a militarized vessel. And therefore, if we decommission it, then perhaps China will allow it to be repaired. Now, I do not know if China will or will not, but certainly that will make us conform with UNCLOS. Coast Guard is considered a civil vessel, and it could also be armed for all intents and purposes.
A former Philippine senator warns the public against falling for Roque's remarks. For Antonio Trillanes, Roque's warning that the Philippines would lose Ayungin Shoal only supports China's narrative.
That's fear-mongering. And I think that's the narrative that China wants to spread. No? And it's ironic that Filipinos are spreading that Chinese propaganda. Hindi lang si Harry Roque, si Duterte mismo. No? During the Duterte administration, ganun sila. Ano sinabi ni Duterte? Gawin nyo na lang Philippine province of China.
Trillanes adds decommissioning the BRP Sierra Madre would be a huge mistake.
That's a trap, okay? And that's what China wants. Okay, remember, kaya hindi ginagalaw yung BRP Sierra Madre. Kahit theoretically, kayang-kayang i-overrun ng PLA yan, ng Chinese Armed Forces. But since a commissioned ship siya ng Philippine Navy, it yeah. may trigger the Mutual Defense Treaty. So the moment you decommission that, then it's now vulnerable, no? Pwede na silang iharas ng iharas until mag-alisan yan.
The U.S. National Security Advisor reaffirms Washington's ironclad support for the Philippines amid China's aggression. Jake Sullivan spoke Monday with his Philippine counterpart, Eduardo Anya Jr., in a phone call. Manila's National Security Council says the two discussed the recent actions by China against Filipino vessels in the West Philippine Sea. The two officials are also looking forward to a leader summit between Japan, the Philippines, and the U.S. in Washington next week. The Philippine Coast Guard regains full access to its official Facebook page today, Tuesday. An unknown entity had hacked the PCG's Facebook page last week, posting violent content. The PCG's website was among several government websites that were hacked in February in a cyber attack traced to a telecom company based in China.
Internet voting will be the primary mode of voting for overseas Filipinos during the 2025 midterm elections. Our correspondent, Victoria Tulad, now on the line with the details. Victoria?
That's correct, Ron. Majority of overseas Filipinos will vote via the internet for next year's May polls. This was the plan the Commission on Elections, or COMELEC, laid out as it held the second round of bidding for the 465.8 million peso online voting and counting system, the second largest contract for next year's polls. According to COMELEC spokesperson, Attorney John Rex Laudianco, the mail-in voting and in-person voting, or voting in embassies and consulates, will only take place in countries with internet restrictions such as Russia, China, and Israel. The poll body will predetermine who will vote with which mode, taking several factors into consideration, such as the policy of a specific nation and the distance of a voter from the embassy or consulate. According to Laudianco, they opted to shift to internet voting for overseas Filipinos for convenience and hopefully a better voter turnout. There were 1.6 million registered overseas Filipino voters during the 2022 presidential elections. Only 600,000 voted. A voter may only enroll one gadget to be able to vote online. Laudianco said the platform will be like a smartphone application, which will be easy to navigate. He also assured the safety and security of the system they will procure. Aside from enrolling for internet voting in order to authenticate one's information and gadget, a person will also be required to have a PIN. Facial recognition is not a requirement, but it is one capability that will be present in the system and ready to be tapped in case the poll body chooses to. Four companies submitted their bids for the internet voting contract: Indra Soluciones Tecnologías de la Información, the joint venture of SMS Global Technologies Incorporated, joint venture of BOWATS Incorporated, and joint venture of AMA Group. We are still awaiting who will be eligible for the contract. Ron?
Victoria Tulad with that update. Thank you very much.
Moving on, more schools suspending in-person classes due to extreme heat. Several local government units in at least seven regions have shifted to alternative mode of teaching as temperatures reach dangerous levels in some areas. These include parts of Negros Occidental, Pangasinan, South Cotabato, and even Metro Manila.
The Philippine Education Department working on initiatives to help schools cope with extreme heat. DepEd Deputy Spokesperson Francis Bringa says the agency is gradually shifting the school year back to a June to March schedule. Bringa adds they are collaborating with the World Bank to make more climate-resilient classrooms. This entails retrofitting and repairing existing classrooms and constructing new infrastructure that can withstand intense weather hazards.
This World Bank funded program on classroom resilient classrooms are actually for implementation by this school year up to the second, by this year up to the up to 2025. So we will be looking at the new designs of climate resilient classrooms by the end of 2025, and hopefully this will be the new design that will be used by the department in its regular school building program.
Health Chief Ted Herbosa Minua says school adjustments amid the hot weather should be made on a case-by-case basis. Herbosa notes learning can still happen in schools with proper ventilation and air conditioning units. He advises schools to consider measures like allowing students to wear light-colored clothes instead of their uniforms and refraining from outdoor activities.
The Philippine Energy Department assures the public of adequate power supply amid a dry season exacerbated by the El Niño phenomenon. The DOE says Luzon still has 2,000 megawatts to spare, while Visayas and Mindanao are still 200 megawatts away from their estimated peak demand. This was a reversal of the agency's earlier statement. The Luzon grid may face yellow alerts in April and May, as falling water levels in dams reduce power supplies from hydroelectric plants. The agency estimates demand for power may peak either in May or June. The public is being encouraged to manage and conserve water amid the impact of El Niño. The El Niño Task Force is issuing this appeal as the country grapples with a dwindling water supply. According to the task force, this can be done by adopting small changes such as avoiding frequent flushing of toilets and using a pail and dipper when taking a bath. The task force's spokesperson, Joey Villarama, also urges households to avail of the services of laundromats to better conserve water.
Actually, yung mga bidet po, magastos yun eh. Kasi, walang habas na pag-spray. So, ang pinakamainam po talaga, gumamit po talaga ng tabo sa tuwing gagamit tayo ng palikuran para po sukat at matipid po yung gamit natin ng tubig. Mas matipid pa nga po yung paggamit po ng laundromat kesa po naglalaba po tayo ng walang habas at yung nagbabanlaw po tayo sa sarili nating bahay.
The Philippines' pertussis outbreak is now under control. That's according to Health Chief Ted Herbosa. He says cases have plateaued, but they continue to closely monitor developments. Herbosa also stressed the need for children to get vaccinated, as pertussis or whooping cough is common among children aged 0 to 5. He, however, notes only children who have no fever, cough, or colds can receive the vaccine. As of March 27, the DOH has recorded nearly 600 pertussis cases across the country. The Senate Sergeant-at-Arms Office turned to Davao City Police to help apprehend troubled televangelist Apollo Kibuloy. Davao Police will aid the Senate in executing the arrest order against Kibuloy, but they admit they are still unaware of the self-styled pastor's whereabouts. According to one of Kibuloy's legal counsels, he's scheduled in the highlands of Davao he is secluded in the highlands of Davao, seeking divine guidance through prayer. Kibuloy is facing an arrest order for failing to appear at a legislative inquiry into his alleged human trafficking and sexual abuse crimes.
Two private contractors of a giant telecommunications firm facing fines for failing to finish roadworks on EDSA after the Holy Week break. Globe Telecom's private contractors, HGC Global Communications and Arlink Corporation, are working on the underground installation of fiber optic cable along the southbound portion of EDSA. But the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority says they failed to comply with the agency's condition that roadworks should have been cleared by Monday, April 1st. This has caused further congestion on one of Metro Manila's busiest roads, which the MMDA expects will last until the end of the week.
Yung epekto po nitong kalokohan nitong mga contractors na ito na nag-iwan po ng bukay sa EDSA ay hindi lamang po naman Lunes lang yung epekto. Mararamdaman pa rin po natin yan 2 to 3 days dahil po yung pagbubuhos po ng semento dyan will take a day or 2 to cure. Yun pong 40 po kasi ang nahukay na kanilang ginawa nitong dalawang contractors na to, 16 na natapos. Yung 16 daw po na yun ay hindi maayos yung pagkaka-restore ng simento.
Substandard.
Kailangan din po daw alisin. Uulitin po. For sure po, itong week na to po will experience talaga po heavy traffic hanggat po maayos po ng tuluyan.
The two firms will be slapped with a 50,000 peso fine per digging per day. The MMDA is also studying the possibility of banning the two from applying for excavation permits in the future.
Up next, Philippine Airlines unveils a new nonstop flight to a major U.S. city.
And the latest market action. More news when we return.
Thanks for watching Top Story. Here again are the headlines. The Philippines' defense chief accuses China of deflecting attention from its illegal activities in the West Philippine Sea.
More schools and local government units across the Philippines suspend in-person classes due to extreme heat.
Cebu City declares a state of water crisis.
And the international community demands accountability after an Israeli airstrike killed 7 aid workers in Gaza.
Seven aid workers killed in an Israeli strike in central Gaza. They include citizens from Australia, Britain, and Poland. The seven workers of the nonprofit World Central Kitchen, who also included Palestinians and a U.S. and Canadian dual citizen, were traveling in two armored cars. Despite coordinating their movements with the Israeli Defense Force, the convoy was hit as it was leaving an aid facility. They had just dropped off more than 100 tons of aid brought to Gaza by sea. The World Central Kitchen condemned the attack, calling it unforgivable. Australia demanding accountability from Israel.
Australia expects full accountability for the deaths of aid workers, which is completely unacceptable. Aid workers and those doing humanitarian work, and indeed all innocent civilians, need to be provided with protection. Australia has had a very clear position of supporting a sustainable ceasefire, of calling for it for some period of time, of calling for humanitarian aid to go to the people of Gaza who are suffering from this deprivation, to make sure that hostages are released as well.
The Israeli military, for its part, said it is conducting a thorough review into the tragic incident.
Israel also accused of a deadly attack on Iran's consulate in the Syrian capital, Damascus. Syrian state media says at least six people were killed and several more were injured in the airstrike. Iranian state media, meanwhile, said one of the fatalities was a senior commander of Iran's Revolutionary Guard, who is believed to be the target of the attack. Iran's ambassador to Syria vowing to respond to the deadly airstrike. Israel, which has repeatedly hit Iranian targets during the six-month war in Gaza, has declined to comment on the reports. In Tehran, Iranian protesters burned Israeli and American flags as they gathered to condemn the attack.
Japan lifts its pause on funding to the UN Agency for Palestinian Refugees. Japanese Foreign Minister Yoko Kamikawa confirmed the funding resumption Tuesday after meeting with UNRWA Chief Philippe Lazzarini last week. The two officials discussed how the UN agency can strengthen its transparency and governance. The European Commission, Canada, Australia, Sweden, and Finland have also lifted their funding pause in recent weeks. The funding halt came after Israel alleged 12 of the agency's staff participated in Hamas's October 7 attack in southern Israel.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu vows to shutter the local office of Qatari news station Al Jazeera. This comes after the Israeli parliament approved a bill allowing the temporary closure of foreign broadcasters considered to be a threat to national security. Al Jazeera, which has been fiercely critical of the military operation in Gaza, calls accusations it has harmed Israel's security a dangerous and ridiculous lie. The White House, meanwhile, expresses concerns over Israel's move.
If it is true, a move like this is concerning. We believe in the freedom of the press. It is critical. It is critically important, and the United States supports the critically important work journalists around the world do. And so, and that includes those who are reporting in the conflict in Gaza.
Back here at home, Cebu City now under a state of water crisis. The local government declared the emergency Tuesday with 28 villages under a state of calamity due to the effects of the El Nino phenomenon. Farmlands have dried up, crops have withered, and residents are scrambling for ration from water trucks. The city council now looking at tapping alternative water sources and the construction of a dam. Cebu's heat index reached 38 degrees Celsius Monday, and according to the latest forecast, mercury is expected to climb to 39 degrees there today, Tuesday. We're now joined by Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama. Mr. Mayor, good afternoon po. Thank you very much for joining us.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, all those viewing your program.
Hi, Mr. Mayor. This declaration of a water crisis in the city follows the placing of around 28 barangays under a state of calamity. First, we want to find out what's the situation in those barangays and how are the residents doing?
Actually, this matter about El Nino has already been a year ago, particularly March, we already made, and I made a marching order to have all those necessities or requirements attended to. Of course, it seems to be going even up to July, as forecasted. And then the manifestations are quite no longer, pleasant, but rather it calls for an alarm. Precisely, I have to declare a water crisis, and this is also being aggravated by the fact that we have an impasse in our water district. And this matter about the impasse is already a year that ought to be resolved, and thank God that LOA already came in and wishing to do their intervention. But as far as the city government, we have our own funding under our quick response, funds to get into, for we have already had the short term, the medium term, and the long term. Mm-hmm. And yesterday, as I had a convergence, there were 11 interventions that are very much needed. And this include food security, water security, and even health security. So all of these are necessitate urgent attention. Funding is also needed now that there is already water crisis declaration in effect, an emergency situation. So the state of calamity will always bring better ease or so-called easement in much technical and very serious or very stringent requirements in releasing funding.
Mr. Mayor, how much funds will be freed up with the declaration of this emergency, this water crisis in the city?
Actually, if you look at it, our funds under our quick response is to the tune of over a billion and even reaching 2 billion. So funding is not going to be a problem here, but having it already acted upon with dispatch is what we need to have. And there are also projects that need to be like this afternoon I attended a very special session on the issue that was being propounded as they call the MCWD management is about the 35% non-revenue water, where if and when addressed, and that's why I've been asking, how much will it take to have all these pipes? How long will it take us to do it? Because if this has been addressed already long time ago, by now we will not be complaining about reduction of water capacity. So therefore, there are really need to have, instead of danda-nandanda, gawa ng gawa ang kailangan. Mm-hmm. So yun ang dapat gawin namin dito, sir, sa Cebu City.
Mr. Mayor, it may take some time before those interventions can be implemented. How is the city taking care of the residents right now, most especially those in the 28 mountain barangays under a state of calamity?
We have been into this in times of Odette, even during COVID, and then there were times that we have also Yolanda, and even during the vaccination matter, where there is a need of a convergence, everybody helping and making things done. And I can assure, under my stewardship, basta tulong-tulungan lang, private sector coming in, government also being bold in making judgment as quick as possible, plus stakeholders at private sectors also helping, then we will be able to manage all of this, especially that we already have also our funding on this matter.
Would you still need assistance from the national government and its agencies, sir?
Depends. If they are quite also helping, but sometimes we might have been to be asking too much when others really may not have the funding. Pinaka-importante dito sa Cebu City ngayon, we're better off economically, we're better off. Private sector are always there to help us out. Even Taipans have been having projects here without even the city government coming in. Like our third bridge, it came from a private-public partnership from MBP, the Sisilic and the Metro Pacific, and others who have been investing here in the city of Cebu. I am pretty sure their corporate social responsibility can operate when it comes to a situation like this. I cannot be naming all of them, but they're all there being ready to be top, and I am pretty sure they will not say no when it comes to the situation that we are into. I will just have to call them to a meeting or by phone asking their help.
Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama, thank you very much, sir, for talking to us.
Welcome.
On to more news, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s approval rating in the first quarter of the year suffered a double-digit dip. According to Pulse Asia's latest survey released today, Marcos's approval rating came in at 55 in March 2024. That's down by 13 points from 68 in December 2023. Vice President Sara Duterte's approval rating also sank by 7 points from 74 in December to 67. As for congressional leaders, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri enjoyed higher approval ratings, while House Speaker Martin Romualdez's performance grade fell by 8 points. The survey was conducted from March 6 to 10, 2024.
Development continues in the sprawling Clark Freeport zone in Pampanga in central Philippines. Officials there tout 44.5 billion pesos worth of investments signed in the first quarter of this year. Clark Development Chief Agnes de Venadera says most of the investments came from leisure and tourism as well as from electronic manufacturing firms. The undertaking is seen to add an initial 5,000 jobs to locals. De Venadera also says plans are underway to develop Clark, which was once a military reservation, into a central business district.
Ang initial nito is about 5,000. 5,000 new workers. In ang meron na tayo sa loob ng Clark is 138,000 workers. So may imagine mo kung gaano karami ang may hanap buhay na dahil dito sa ating mga mamumuhanan na nagpupunta sa Clark. Clark has two faces. One is the business, one is the leisure. So, live, work, and play. Yan yung motto natin. That's the thing that is available in Clark. So, we have not left the idea and the plan of creating the central business district. It's still in the offing and we're still working on it.
President Marcos creates a committee that will address land acquisition issues to speed up big-ticket rail projects. Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista says the creation of the Interagency Committee for Right-of-Way Activities for National Railway Projects is a huge boost to the railway sector. Bautista will serve as the body's chairman with the Secretary of the Department of Human Settlements and Urban Development as co-chair. Ongoing rail projects like the MRT3 and the Metro Manila Subway have faced challenges due to land acquisition issues.
Philippine shares slide to negative territory despite an increase in foreign buying. Michelle Long with the market action.
Coming Recovering from their best start to the year since 2019, Asian equity benchmarks traded in narrow range Tuesday as traders recalibrate Fed rate cut expectations following solid economic data out of the U.S. Hong Kong's Hang Seng Index outperformed, with Xiaomi among the best performing stocks following the debut of its electric vehicle. Here at home, the PSE index slipped by a third of 1% to close at 6960 after earlier testing 7,000 intraday.
We're seeing foreign inflow backed rallies right now, and you know that's what's really encouraging about the rallies that we're seeing now. You know, especially the net foreign buying part. We have seen consecutive days of net foreign buying in the first quarter of this year, and you know, having those high volumes, high NFB, consecutive days of NFB support price action. We think that really gives credibility to the uptrend that we're seeing now.
In corporate stories, C-REIT, the Philippines' first and largest renewable energy REIT, which got fresh capital injection following its share sale to SM Investments last week, posted a 12% growth in 2023 income to 1.4 billion pesos, its second year as a full-fledged REIT company. This on the back of strong guaranteed base lease, augmented by new properties acquired in 2023, that 7 parcels of land totaling 5.12 million square meters of value-accretive assets. The company's unique green asset portfolio, growing 4.3 times since its IPO in 2022. Still in earnings after PAL Holdings' blowout results, another Lushutan company, this time Macro Asia, an aviation support service provider, reports 2023 bottom line more than doubled to nearly 1.1 billion pesos as revenue hit a record. It cites a strong rebound of its core aviation services units, supported by business units that rapidly grew with non-aviation related revenue sources. It notes about 2 billion. Or 24% of its full-year revenue came from activities outside of the airport, in contrast to 2019, where non-aviation revenues amounted to only 7% of consolidated revenues. The food segment saw revenue jump 74% for the year, while revenues from the water business went up 20%. Meanwhile, the Gokongwei's JG Summit confirmed setting 2024 CAPEX budget at 87.2 billion pesos, down 12% year-on-year. The bulk is going to Cebu Air, which is spending nearly 49 billion for additional aircraft acquisition, while Robinson's Land is getting around 22 billion to expand the commercial spaces of its malls and offices, as well as build more hotel rooms. While its food manufacturing unit, C2 and chippy maker Universal Robina, is getting around 13 billion to construct and outfit its plants, including the 31-hectare Malvar property. Finally, Visman developer Cebu Land Masters expects 2024 to log in the same growth momentum, saying the challenge is to not grow too fast and over-leverage, but to grow sustainably. Among the tailwinds, input inflation from steel, concrete to cost of capital already peaking last year, and a healthy backlog where developers are barely making a dent. It also teased about an upcoming project in the works for their first foray in Luzon.
The backlog just continues to grow. In Cebu, it's roughly about, within Metro Cebu and Central Visayas, it's roughly about 1 billion housing units. Put that in context, in our 20-year history, we built about 40,000 houses. And we're already the number one residential developer in this region. That just gives you a size of how much more demand we should be serving into from the past, in addition to what we should be serving, you know, going forward. We're looking at around 12 projects this year. We're expanding into new markets like Butuan and General Santos. And we haven't been shy in saying that we have an eye towards expanding in Luzon. We're engaged with certain landowners so that we could start making inquiries and, in fact, making moves towards acquisitions and developments there. The total value of those 12 projects should be north of 20 billion. Talks are serious. The intention is there. We've put in time and resources to explore some very serious and, frankly, some very exciting opportunities. Who exactly we're going to partner with and where. But, before anything gets done, we want to make sure that anything that is confirmatory, before we disclose anything.
Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Airlines is adding yet another destination in the U.S. The flag carrier announced today it will offer nonstop flights from Manila to Seattle starting October. The service will be available thrice a week. The Washington state is PAL's sixth destination in the U.S. and its eighth in North America. Aside from bringing more American tourists to the Philippines, PAL is also optimistic of serving more Filipinos who will visit family and friends in the area.
A Filipino woman CEO in South Jersey pays success forward by offering scholarships to young women. Don Tagala tells us more about Lita Marcelo Abela's career and how she's given back to the community.
So I'm very happy. I'm very happy, and at my age, retirement is not in my vocabulary. I still want to work.
At 72 years old, Lita Marcelo Abel is at the helm of a multi-million enterprise in South Jersey. She's the president and CEO of US Lumber, a building supplies business established by her husband in 1974. Today, US Lumber is an industry leader in specialty plywoods and building products in the tri-state area.
This is our warehouse. We store the plywood.
Their clients range from state colleges and casinos in New Jersey, stadiums in Philadelphia, to skyscrapers like the World Trade Center in New York City.
I always want to be, you know, a boss or my own business, things like that. And I'm dreaming and dreaming and dreaming. And I never thought that my dream will come true.
After finding success as a woman in minority-owned business, Marcelo Abel is giving back by helping young women achieve their own dreams. With an initial $10,000 endowment scholarship to the Rowan College in South Jersey.
Instead of us being the recipient of endowments or scholarships, ito isang Filipina ang nagbibigay ng scholarship sa kanyang community.
What we hope will happen, other businesses, other women who lead businesses will speak to our students, mentor our students, encourage them, scholarship opportunity, but hopefully and possibly other donors will now come to the table.
In honor of her contribution, Rowan College named its new Women's Institute for Business after the Filipina entrepreneur.
But she is all about giving back to the community, and that is why we're celebrating her today.
It is amazing to be able to name this institute after someone who has overcome so much and has shown what it takes to be a successful woman in business.
Marcelo Abel was a high school teacher in the Philippines before she came to the U.S. in 1981 to work as a housekeeper and babysitter so she can provide for her family back home. Little did she know that she will be serving a family in three different households in New York. She says she would work more than 8 hours a day without overtime pay, while her employer treated her like a personal slave. After pulling off an escape, she left her employer and found a better one who employed her as a nanny. But it was meeting and marrying her husband, Mariel Leslie Abel, that changed her life forever. Together, they formed a formidable team in business.
So my husband and I will go out on the road. He will be driving. I will be soliciting. I'll be soliciting the business. And then when they call, get prices, I give it to my husband because that is his forte.
Today, her husband owns 46% of the business. Her daughter Romulet owns 6%. And Marcela Abel has 48%. This then qualified U.S. Lumber as woman-owned, minority-owned business. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New Jersey.
In the state of Maryland, a temporary channel has opened for emergency vessels responding to the bridge collapse in Baltimore. Governor Wes Moore said the temporary channel will allow a limited number of tugboats and barges to get to the container ship stuck in the Patapsco River. Traffic leading to the Port of Baltimore, one of the busiest on the eastern seaboard, has been closed since Tuesday last week after the cargo ship struck the bridge, causing it to fall into the river. U.S. President Joe Biden will be traveling to Baltimore Friday to meet with local officials as he surveys the damage.
The president is continuing to lead a whole-of-government approach to the collapse. President Biden and his team are working with Governor Moore, the congressional delegation, Mayor Scott, and numerous state and local officials to reopen the port, rebuild the bridge, and support the people of Baltimore.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump posts a $175 million bond in this New York civil fraud case. The bond payment prevents state authorities from seizing Trump's assets, including Trump Tower and his Mar-a-Lago estate in Florida. Trump is accused of fraudulently inflating his net worth by billions to secure better loan and insurance terms. Trump has denied any wrongdoing, insisting the case is a political witch hunt.
Switching gears now, the music of a Caloocan-based rapper who is passionate about women empowerment has caught the attention of Hollywood music producers. Our Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez tells us more.
Zay Zacarias, who goes by her artist name Zay, raps about rapping the Morenas and writes about the struggles of Filipino women. Her songs, which she has been independently releasing on online platforms since 2019, have caught the attention of Hollywood music supervisors. On her Instagram, Zay posted her reaction while watching a scene in the Netflix hit series The Gentlemen when it premiered on March 7. In it, Tagalog lyrics can be heard as her music plays.
How did it come about?
Actually, we received an email and I was like, The Gentlemen, for real? I was just waiting for the confirmation kasi it's a big deal. It's a huge opportunity for Filipino music, di ba? Para ma-feature sa isang international shows.
But as the 23-year-old Caloocan rapper explains, Zay's Hollywood adventure is just a fun cherry on top of her rapidly flourishing career. She writes and performs to express her perspective as a young Filipina who owns her power, generational trauma, gender inequality, and patriarchal barriers notwithstanding.
I really just wanted to make a statement piece about women empowerment. Mm-hmm. Kasi ano, hindi lang yung female rappers sa Philippines right now. And there had to be someone who says something about it. And I just wanted to do it. Mm-hmm. And inspiration ko din talaga is gusto kong, I want to write about women in a way na ang sinasabi nung kanta is how strong we are, how hardworking we are, that we are hustlers, we get our own money. Filipino women, ayun lang po talaga yung motivation ko dun sa song na yun. And yung inspiration ko din is yung mom ko, siya yung pinaka-hardworking person I know.
Her mom, whom Zay calls Mama V, works as a teacher and she raised the rapper and her sister single-handedly. Zay started in the industry as a dancer, so for her music videos, apart from being the talent and producer, she also serves as a choreographer. It's through online platforms like YouTube and Spotify that Zay's music was first discovered by Hollywood music supervisors. The Cleaning Lady was the first U.S. TV series that used Zay's music.
As an independent artist, ano yung challenges mo?
I don't have a marketing team. It's really a one-woman show. I'm also self-produced po kasi ako. Like, yung sa financial side ng art, syempre, you need money to make art. Mm-hmm. And isa din yun sa, I don't like to say struggle kasi hindi naman masyadong struggle kasi nakaipo naman ako dun from my hits. Mm-hmm. Pero ako po yung naglalabas ng money para makagawa ako ng art. Mm-hmm. And the gigs as a freelancer is not stable. So I'm really just risking it all for a dream that only I can see. And it's my choice naman po to be an independent artist right now. I've talked to a lot of labels then and distributors. I'm just really waiting for the right time and the right deal to come. Because I know my worth. I mean, I'm a rising star pa lang. I'm on the come up. But I know the value that artists bring.
Zay's musical influences include Beyoncé and Megan Thee Stallion. She's also currently working on her EP to be released this year. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
A Filipino-Canadian content creator puts a spin on the classic tale of the web crawler Spider-Man. Jocelyn Reyes Sambila introduces us to the Filipino Spider-Man.
Oh yeah. In this world, one and only, Spider-Man. Yeah, who'd have thought? This universe is Spider-Man. It's Filipino.
Meet Ralph Montero, the Filipino Spider-Man variant from Toronto, Canada. Directed and portrayed by full Canadian content creator Carlos Rico, Spider-Man Ralph is his debut film, a passion project that has captivated audiences worldwide.
My first time acting, my first time directing, my first time writing. So this is just something I always wanted to do and had to be something that's not yet done and something that we're kind of missing. The audience needs to see. And that's a Filipino Spider-Man.
Rico says the film is not the traditional Spider-Man story.
Unlike Peter Parker and unlike the other Spider-Man, he grew up in a harsh environment, not the same as the regular Spider-Man. Raphael, since he grew up in a harsh environment where it wouldn't help him be a good person, if that person were to get powers, what would they use it for?
Drawing inspiration from his Filipino heritage, Rico infused the film with cultural elements, like the yellow costume inspired by the St. Andrew Cross spider found in the Philippines. Rico and his team even shot some scenes in the Philippines to add more authenticity to the film.
So we tie it in by the spider that Raphael gets bit by is from the Philippines. And then it's one of those fighting spiders. And it matches perfectly to the duality because Raphael, since he's in that harsh environment, he's actually a street fighter.
Before jumping into filmmaking, Rico gained fame as a TikTok star, known for his podcast Jumpers Jumped with his friend Gavin Ruta.
He motivates me a lot because he just does whatever he comes to mind. So the Jumpers Jump podcast, the whole reason why we did it is the underlying message is jump for your dream.
The Phil Canadian admits that he lacks formal education in film directing. He says he had to learn the art on his own and through his experience in content creation. Rico hopes that his example will inspire others to pursue their passion. His mother, Hazel, is also part of the film. She expressed her family's support for her son's accomplishments.
It's frightening.
I'm very, very proud of Carlos for achieving this goal and to see him like this, very popular, and to be able to inspire a lot of people. Talaga pong nakakatuwa po siyang nakita kong na lumaki ng ganito.
Spider-Man Ralph has already garnered over 240,000 views on YouTube after its release on March 12. Rico hopes that Marvel and Sony will take notice and will bring Spider-Man Ralph into the mainstream.
The goal is to reach out to Marvel and Sony and the creators of Marvel and those comics that I can bring the Filipino Spider-Man to their universe.
Rico and his team are now gearing up for Spider-Man Ralph Volume 2, promising even more excitement and depth to the character. Jocelyn Reyes Sambilay, ABS-CBN News, Toronto.
And before we go, the White House press corps got a good laugh on April 1st as they were greeted by a giant Easter bunny. During the White House press briefing, Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre stood alongside the bunny, saying the White House would revoke the Hatch Act, which prohibits federal employees from using their official capacity to affect or interfere with elections. It was all part of an April Fool's prank. The White House also pulled off such stunts in previous April Fool's days. Back in 2013, it posted a fake video message from the kid president, addressing the nation from his own White House lectern. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay. You can watch highlights and recaps of our shows online on ANC 24/7 on Facebook and YouTube.
I'm Ron Crows. You can also subscribe to ANC Prestige on YouTube to get access to our full lineup of shows. Thank you for watching.